Praise the Lord. Everybody, I said, praise the Lord. Rise up now as we pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we bless your name. We thank you, Lord, because we know that Christ, our Savior, our Lord, our Commander-in-Chief, and the Captain of our salvation is still on the throne. And we pray, Lord, that you manifest yourself in the teaching of your word in Jesus' name. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the child of God, the man of God, the woman of God, the minister of God may be perfect and complete, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Therefore, Lord, we're praying at this time, as your word comes forth, teach us by this word and transform our lives in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, that whatever Calvary has provided for our spirit, for our soul, for our mind, for our body, for our present, for the future, for our destiny, fulfill in every life in Jesus' name. Keep us standing on the truth. Make us sound in the faith that, Lord, nothing contrary to the word will ever stand in our lives. Well, thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. We're coming to Romans chapter 12. And I'm reading to you from verses 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. As we look at those two verses of scriptures, you'll find it uses a particular word. It says in verse 1, therefore, it's saying, I'm pleading with you, I beseech you, I beg of you, I'm imploring you, that because of the things that have been said, uttered, declared, proclaimed, taught before this chapter 12, because of that, therefore, you present yourselves unto God as a living sacrifice, and that sacrifice to be acceptable in the sight of the Lord must be holy, dedicated unto the Lord, surrendered unto the Lord, giving unto the Lord. In fact, it says, it's as a result of that, yourself, your service, your worship will be acceptable unto the Lord. And it is as a result of that, you will know the perfect and the good will of God for your life. Those two verses talk about consecration and non-conformity to the world. Consecration and non-conformity to this world. As you look at the epistle to the Romans, it's an epistle that talks about our justification by faith. That means our salvation by faith. That means our reconciliation with God through the grace of God. Chapters 1, 2, and 3 talk about the guilt the condemnation of Jews and Gentiles. It says, we have all sinned in the past, and we came short of the glory of God. Chapter 4, chapter 5 talks about our redemption, our salvation. It talks about Abraham saved by faith, not by circumcision. It talks about David saved by faith, not by royalty. It talks about the Jews and the Gentiles, the circumcised and the uncircumcised. And it says there is only one way of salvation, whether in the Old Testament or the New Testament. It is by faith in the sacrificial lamb that died for us and took our place. Then chapter 6 talks about our sanctification. It talks about the very fact that the old man is crucified, and now we should not serve sin, and that the body of sin, the root of sin, the nature of sin is dealt with at Calvary. Chapter 7 reminds us of what we were. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me out of this body of death? But you say, thank the Lord, because Jesus Christ has come. And because Jesus Christ has come, it's done the work in us. Our sins are forgiven. Our condemnation is taken away. And the power of sin is broken. Because of that, we now walk in the Spirit. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who walk in the Spirit and not in the flesh, because the law of Christ has set us free from the law of sin and death. Chapters 9, 10, and 11 talk about, at present, the people of the covenant, the Jews, they are under a kind of dispensational blindness. Blindness has come to the Jews now, and light has come for the Gentiles. The door is open for the Gentiles, for the Gentiles to come, for you and I to come into all that Calvary through Christ has provided for us. It now comes to the practical aspect. It says, therefore, look at what Christ has done. Look at what's available for us. It says, because of that, our response to what Christ has done is consecration and non-conformity to this world. It calls upon you. Are you saved? Are you a child of God? Have you passed through Calvary? Has Calvary influenced your life, changed your life, turned you around? There is one thing then you must have. You bring yourself as a sacrifice unto the Lord. A living sacrifice that is holy, that is not conformed to this world, and you present yourself without reservation unto the Lord. Totally, completely, entirely surrendered, committed, consecrated unto the Lord. That's what we're looking at. I divide the message to three parts. Number one, blameless and acceptable sacrifice unto the Lord. That you see yourself, that I am not living for myself. I'm not desiring to go my own way. But Lord, I come. I bring myself, my totality, my entirety, my complete self, body, soul, and spirit. Everything I have been, everything I am, everything I hope to be, my past, my present, my future, my skill, my ability, everything I've ever got, everything I will ever have. I bring everything as a complete, holy, purified, sanctified sacrifice unto you. That's why we look at that point number one, blameless and acceptable sacrifice unto the Lord. Number two, blessed and absolute absolute surrender, not partial surrender. Because Jesus on the cross of Calvary did not make a partial surrender, a partial giving of himself. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And the sacrifice, the submission, the surrender that Jesus did on the cross of Calvary for your salvation, for your acceptance, reconciliation unto the Lord, it was not a partial thing. It was complete. It was absolute, absolute surrender. That's why you reciprocate. You respond, you repay, you say, Lord, because of what you've done for me and how you did it for me, I come and I make an absolute surrender of who I am, who I will ever be unto you. Blessed, an absolute surrender to the Lord. Number three, biblical and approved service to the Lord. Biblical and approved service unto the Lord. Number one, blameless and acceptable sacrifice to the Lord. I come to that chapter 12 again of Romans. Romans chapter 12. I beseech you therefore, I plead with you therefore, brethren, these are born again people, brethren, these are sons and daughters of God, brethren, these are the people, the ecclesia, the people who are called out of the world. They are reconciled with God. They are members of the family of God. They have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Because of that, they are brethren. It says, these are my brothers and sisters who do the will of God. These are the people that are open to doing the will of God. And they do not have any intention, any ambition, any desire here in the world, but just to be fully, completely surrendered, committed, consecrated, given to the Lord. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, the mercy that saves us invites us to consecration. The mercy that healed us brings us to consecration. The mercy that forgave our sin, the mercy that forgot our sins, the mercy that brings us into the kingdom by the mercies in the plural. Mercy through salvation, mercy for sanctification, mercy for healing, mercy for deliverance. Every time those people wanted to get healed, Son of David, Jesus, have mercy on me. It's the mercy of God that saved us, the mercy of God that healed us, the mercy of God that delivered us, the mercy of God that has reconciled us, the mercy of God that gives us grace upon grace and love upon love, the mercy of God that makes us the beloved of the Lord. By those mercies of God, he calls upon you, he calls upon me, and he says that you present your body a living sacrifice unto God. There's some ignorant churchgoers, difficult to call them believers. They say God has nothing to do with their body. Is that so? They say that religion has nothing to do with their body. They can paint it. They can perforate it. They can deck it. They can hang a lot of abominable things on that body. They say it doesn't matter. That their soul is what God is concerned about. They say their spirit is what God is concerned about. But here it says that you present your bodies. Did you see the plural there? That is, the pastor, present your body. Wife or pastor, present your body. The preachers, present your bodies. The women leaders, present your body. And the workers, men and women, present your bodies. And the believers who say they are born again, the children of God, bodies in the plural, that you present all those bodies entirely, completely, without reservation and without modifying, mutilating the word of God. Present yourself unto God, and then it will be a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice. It will be a dead sacrifice if it is contaminated with sin. It will be a dead sacrifice if it has anything of Satan in it. It will be a dead sacrifice if the old life of Adam, of disobedience, is in it. That's why it says, because it says, the day that you eat of the fruit of that tree, you will surely die. And if you eat the forbidden fruit, and you drink the forbidden sin, and you inhale the forbidden sin, the day you eat of the fruit of that tree, you will die. And so it says, don't bring a dead sacrifice. Go to Calvary. Come alive. Go to Calvary. Let your sins be forgiven. Go to Calvary and let the resurrection power of Christ raise you up and cancel that spiritual death. Then come and present your bodies unto God, a living sacrifice. You will do it. I said you will do it. Why do we have to do that? 1 Corinthians chapter 6. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 19. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. And we're reading from verse 19 and verse 20. What? Know ye not that your body, not just your soul, not just your spirit, not just your mind, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? It says, you cannot just do whatever you like with your body. I feel, this is what I'll do. No, you cannot feel, it doesn't belong to you. I think, this is what I'm going to do with my body. No, it doesn't belong to you. Don't you know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? That Holy Spirit is within you if you are born again. Born of the Spirit, born of water, born of the Word. It says in verse 20, for ye are bought with a price. It's the price of Calvary. It's the price of the shedding of the blood of Christ. It is the price of the suffering, the agony of Christ on the cross. It says, for ye are bought with a price, therefore. You see that word therefore? Because you are bought with a price. Because you do not belong to yourself. Because you are the purchase of God. Because the price of the blood of the Lamb has brought you into the kingdom, and you are a purchased property. It says, because of that, glorify God. Don't glorify self. Because of that, glorify God. Don't glorify man. Because of that, glorify God. Don't glorify the world. Because of that, therefore, glorify God in your body. You see that? That is, the way your body is presented to the Lord, given to the Lord, sacrificed to the Lord, surrendered unto the Lord, it says, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. It tells us that this is the sacrifice we have to render unto the Lord. Already it tells you the condition of that body. I surrender it unto the Lord. If the condition is not the condition of righteousness, the condition of holiness and the condition of purity. You cannot offer each other, Lord, and God is going to demand something of you. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm reading here from verse 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God? You see the repetition there. It says, if you're a believer, if you're a child of God, this must be the constant understanding and the constant perception and the constant action, the thing that influences you, forms your action, leads you in the direction you go. It says, this you must know, that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you. Don't you know that? Look at verse 17. If any man, you know, sometimes there are some preachers, thank God they are not here, they belong to maybe those other places, but they talk as if they are exempted from the word of God. They think that, you know, the power is for them, but the commandments are for the rest of us. They think that the authority is for them, but they think that the demands of the gospel, the commandments of the word of God, that God demands that this is what you do, they think that's for the rest of us. They think that the benefit of Calvary, healed by the stripes of Christ, provided for, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory. They think that the benefit of Calvary belongs to them, but they think that the behavior of a child of God belongs to the rest of us. But here you see it says, if any man, pastor, or the man in the pew, a preacher, or a member of the church, if any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. For the temple of God is holy, which temple ye are. It tells you then, as we're going to present his temple back to him, because the temple belongs to him, for him to live there, for him to reside there, for him to abide there, for him to do his work there, for him to fulfill his will in his temple, we present it to him, it must be holy to be a living sacrifice. And I pray God will help you. I say God will help you, that the presentation of your sacrifice unto the Lord will be acceptable unto the Lord. In Psalm 50, I'm reading from verse 5. Psalm 50, verse 5. Psalm 50, verse 5. The sacrifice that he calls upon us to present unto the Lord. In Psalm 50, verse 5, it says, gather my sinners. Tell me out loud. Tell me. You know, sometimes some churches give us an idea that's only when you die you become a saint. That's why you have Saint Augustine after you died. That's how you have Saint Peter after he died, Saint Paul after he died. But you know what the Bible says? While you're still alive, the Lord takes you from the position of a sinner and he makes you a saint. He cleanses your life. He takes your sin away. He removes the very power of sin. It breaks the power of sin from your life. And you carry yourself from morning till evening with the consciousness, I'm not a sinner anymore. My sins are gone. My sins are forgiven. the blood of Jesus Christ has washed me. I am a saint. And the Lord said, gather my saints together, verse 5, unto me. That's the word of the Lord. And I pray you'll be one of his saints. I said you'll be one of his saints. You know, many people, preachers, writers, authors, they say they are sinners saved by grace. You are sinners before you were saved by grace. Once you become saved, forgiven, cleansed, changed, transformed, if any man be in Christ, tell me, is a new creature. Old things are passed away. And behold, how many things now? How many things in your life? I said, how many things in your language? How many things in your dressing? All things have become new. Gather my saints together unto me. Those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. That's the sacrifice he expects of you. That you bring yourself now to God, a living sacrifice. And it must be a holy sacrifice. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 1. 1 Timothy chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 1. It says in verse 1, 1 Timothy chapter 5, rebuke not an elder, but entreat him as a father, and the younger men as brethren, the elder women, older women as mothers, and the younger as, tell me, sisters, with what? Say it loud. All purity. Purity in your interaction with the sisters, if you're a man, you're a brother. Purity in your language, discussion with the sisters, if you're a brother. Purity in your relationship, your thoughts, your talk, your attitude. Purity. It says you relate with the sisters, the younger ones, with all purity. And then it also says, look at verse 22 now. In verse 22, it says, lay hands suddenly on no man, neither be partaker of other men's sins. You want to present yourself a holy sacrifice, a pure sacrifice, an acceptable sacrifice unto the Lord. It says, this is what to do. That there will be purity in your life. You keep yourself pure, and you will not be a partaker with other men's sins. There are some people that want to sin. They want to backslide, but they are not happy to sin alone. They are not happy to backslide alone. They are not happy to go to hell alone. They say, will you come with me? Ahab telling Jehoshaphat, do you know that Ramoth Gilead belongs to us and is in the hands of these Assyrians? Will you come along with me? Ahab was a backslider, and Jehoshaphat was still a king, a good righteous king. Unfortunately, Jehoshaphat said, I am like you are, you are like I am, I will go with you. He almost lost his life. I pray you'll not die another person's death. I said you'll not die another person's death. Ahab knew he was going to die. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. But he wanted to shift that death on Jehoshaphat. So he said, Jehoshaphat, you dress like a king. I will disguise myself. Jehoshaphat did not know. He was trying to transfer his death penalty on Jehoshaphat. Nobody will transfer their death to you. That's why it says that you will not be partaker of other men's sins. Keep yourself pure. That's how you bring that holy, pure, righteous, acceptable sacrifice unto the Lord. Point number two, blessed and absolute surrender unto the Lord. Blessed and absolute surrender unto the Lord. What this means is that you will give what belongs to God back to the Lord. Come back to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, reading from verse 1 again. It says in chapter 12, verse 1, I, Paul the apostle, I, the servant of the Lord, I, the ambassador of Christ, I, the representative of Christ. What does a representative do? A representative representing an authority, representing a personality, will tell you exactly what the person is representing, what the person will tell you. And it says, I come to you now, telling you what Christ would have told you. As a representative of Christ, I beseech you, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. The presentation of your body is a surrender of your body, is a surrender of your life, is a consecration of your life. Present it unto God, a living sacrifice. Let nothing defile your sacrifice. You know, anytime you come to offer something to the Lord, whether it's your time, or your talent, or your treasure, or your very life, or your skill, or your ability, or any gift you have, you want to present to the Lord, Satan is jealous. Look at Jesus. As Jesus was there in that house, a woman came and poured an alabaster box of ointment on him. And there was a thief there. His name, Judas Iscariot. He was jealous. How do you pour all this on Christ? And he said, this is a waste. It's wastage. You could have sold this for 300 pence, a penny a day. That's the wages of 300 days. When you remove all the Sabbaths of the year and all the holidays of the year, it will remain just about 300. That's a whole year's salary of those days. You pour it on Christ at a time. Everything your strength has accumulated, everything your ability has gathered together for a whole year, you pour it on Christ. For Judas Iscariot, the thief, he was jealous. Said, this wastage, and Satan is a thief. He comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. And anytime you are putting everything you have on Christ and you surrender and you give to Christ everything you've got, that thief, Satan, is jealous. Abraham came to offer sacrifice unto the Lord. And while he offered the sacrifice, the birds of prey, the vultures, they were flying over the sacrifice. They wanted to defile the sacrifice, desecrate the sacrifice. They wanted to remove the sacrifice and was driving them away. You need to do that as you lay your life on the altar for God. Jealous Satan, jealous servants of Satan, They'll say, you're going to give everything to the Lord like that. You're going to deny yourself. And you're going to deny yourself of necessary pleasure, necessary satisfaction, and put everything on Christ. Those are the birds that Abraham drove away. You will drive them away. You see, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. The world behind me and the cross before me. No turning back. No turning back. God is preparing a kingdom. And I am going into that kingdom with all my soul, my spirit, my body entirely. No reservation. No turning back. No turning back. Friends may oppose me. I mean, friends may depart from me, and my friends may persecute, yet I will follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. The world may try to entice me and call me and say, don't go too far, come, come. I tell them bye bye to the world. Jesus is my Lord. Jesus is my King. I give, I devote, I sacrifice, I surrender, I consecrate everything I've got unto the Lord. No turning back, no turning back. You will not turn back. And that is the sacrifice the Lord is calling you to. You will make it. I said you will make it. And be not conformed to this world. The world would like to suck you in to their system. Maybe the system of sports, games, leave evangelism, leave church, only sports and games. The world will not take you away from Christ. The world may want to suck you in into their system of politics. That the only thing they think about, politics and the local government, politics in the region, politics in the state, politics in the nation, politics in the continent. But the world is trying to say, how do you give all your time to Christ? How do you give all your talent to Christ? How do you give all your training to Christ? Politics needs you. Come and fight with us. We're fighting everybody. And you join in the fight. Politics will not take you away from Christ. I didn't hear your amen. Amen. You know tradition? Tradition of your village? The tradition of your local government? The tradition of your tribe? They try to suck you in. They say, where are you? Where do you always go? We need you here. You are the son of the soil. And this is what you must do. They are jealous of Christ. They say, with all the talent you have, with all the ability you have, with all the possibilities before you, you are our son here. You can represent us in that other place. And you have gone. Come back. We need you. We need you to your totality, your Sunday, your Saturday, your Wednesday, your Thursday, your Monday, everything, your education, your business, your acumen, whatever it is you have, bring here. Your tribe needs you. You are not a tribal man anymore. I said you are not a tribal man anymore. You belong to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. Am I talking to somebody there? I belong to Jesus. When the world comes and knocks at the door, tell them, I've gone to Jesus. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the captain of my salvation. He's my Redeemer. He's coming. He will appear one day in the sky. And this world, you will not tie me down. When the saints go marching in, I will be there with them. I'll go marching in with them in Jesus' name. tell the world I'm no more for them. Tell the world they will not find me. I've given everything I know, everything I have, everything I've got, everything I will ever be. I've given it to Jesus. I belong to Jesus. Anybody belonging to Jesus somewhere, their body, soul, and spirit, past, present, and future, and your destiny is in the hand of Jesus Christ. Where is he? Where is she? It is confirmed in Jesus' name. Your life then is to be lived to attract Jesus, to please Jesus, to be devoted unto Jesus. And you are not conformed to this world, but you are transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and the perfect will of God. It will happen. I need a good amen. You know, the thing, what the Lord is calling us to. Look at this, Second Samuel. I'm reading from chapter 15. Second Samuel, chapter 15. And we're looking at verse 15. Second Samuel, chapter 15, verse 15. Blessed and absolute surrender unto the Lord. In 2 Samuel chapter 15, verse 15, and the king's servants said unto the king, behold, thy servants are ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. Jesus is the king, and you are his servant. And you are saying unto the king who loved you so much and died for you, and he shed the very last drop of his blood for you. That's why when they threw that spear to his side, all that came out, water and blood. The blood had finished. The blood started flowing out from the Garden of Gethsemane when he prayed in agony, Father, if this cup will not pass by me, except I drink it, Lord, Father, thy will be done. And the Bible says, while he was praying, there were great sweat of blood coming out of every part of his body. The agony was so much. The heart was undergoing excruciating pain and agony for your sin. Not only that, after he prayed like that, great drops of blood coming out, he was tied to the post, and they gave him lashes. Those lashes had stones and sharp bones and sharp metals in them. Every time they laid it off on him, it drew great parcels of flesh and blood out of his body. His blood was being drained for you. And then, as he was weak, they took him up and they laid the cross on his shoulder. He was so weak because he's lost so much blood. He fell under the weight of the cross he bore for you. And then they nailed him to that cross. While they were nailing him, the blood was kind of spluttering out. And then they put him on the cross there, and a crown of thorns on his head. All the back already bleeding, losing blood. All the sweat of blood already coming out. And then the crown of thorns, they pierced his head, and blood came out. And now when they throw the spear, that was the last thing. All the blood was gone. He shed his blood for you. And yet it is your king. That's why now, as a servant of God, as a child of God, you are telling him in chapter 15, verse 15, and the king's servant said unto the king, behold, the servants are ready. Are you ready? Ready to do whatsoever my lord the king shall appoint. When you come to that point and you sincerely, wholeheartedly surrender to the Lord, there's no argument with the Lord anymore. There is no bargaining with the Lord anymore. He has commanded, and that is what we will do. 1 Kings chapter 20. In 1 Kings chapter 20, I'm reading from verse 4. First Kings chapter 20 verse 4. And the king of Israel answered, my Lord, O king, according to thy saying, I am thine and all that I have. That's the language of a true believer. If you really accept Jesus as your Savior, as your Lord, if it is not lip service, if it is not an empty, shallow, meaningless, worthless word of mouth, if in reality you belong to Christ, if in reality you are born again, if in reality you have been to Calvary, if in reality you have said, Lord Jesus, I give my life unto you, I belong to you, you are my Savior, you are my Lord, you are my King. If your confession is anything that heaven will approve of and write about, here is what you say. You say, as the king of Israel answered and said, he said, my Lord, O king, according to thy saying, I am thine and all that I have. I pray that that will be your true, wholehearted, sincere, abiding statement unto the Lord in Jesus' name. Point number three, biblical and approved service to the Lord. Biblical and approved service unto the Lord. We're coming back to Romans chapter 12. And I'm reading from verses 1 and 2. It says, I beseech you, I beg of you, I plead with you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, by the compassion of God, by the love of God, by the grace of God that has saved you and sanctified you and brought you into the kingdom, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present, nobody will do it for you, nobody will force you, you present. If you value Calvary, you present yourself. If you appreciate Calvary, you present yourself. If you are truly thankful for Calvary, and if it is in reality that you know that Jesus is your Savior, if you know the depths of the love of Christ, the height of the love of Christ, if you know the extent that Jesus went, and if you value the sacrifice, the agony, the suffering of Calvary for you, here is what you do. Nobody forces you. You see, in appreciation of his sacrifice, in appreciation of his love, in appreciation of his agony for me on the cross of Calvary, I surrender, I present myself, my body to him, a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, the world of evil, the world of fashion, the world of politics, the world of duplicity, deception, and diplomacy, that should be not conformed to this world. It's an evil world, Satan ruled world. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that she may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. For the love of Christ constraineth us. I look at Calvary, I'm constrained. I look at his sacrifice, I'm compelled. It says, the love of Christ, the sacrifice of Christ, compels us, constrains us, drives us, pleads with us, forces us, drives us to surrendering ourselves, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then were all dead. That he that died, that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth from now on live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Your attitude, your heart, your life will be that for the rest of your life, every moment, every day, you now want to live to the glory of his name. John chapter 12. In John chapter 12, reading from verse 24. John chapter 12, reading from verse 24. It says, verily, verily I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die. He's talking about you. Except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. The way to serve the Lord, reward deeply. The way to serve the Lord with fruit, abiding fruit, is to forget about yourself and let that self fall into the ground and die, so that it's no more of me, it's no more of you, it's no more my desires, it's no more my pleasure. All I want now is to please the Lord who has graciously saved me. And except that corn of wheat will fall into the ground and die, it will abide alone. Your life will be lonely, your life will be worthless, your life will be useless, your life will not contribute anything to the king or to the kingdom. But if you want a life that contributes something significant to the king and to the kingdom of God, let that corn of wheat fall into the ground and die. You're not looking for the praise of men anymore. You're not looking for your own pleasure, satisfaction, fulfillment, aggrandizement, or whatever anymore. All you want now is the exaltation and the glory of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It tells us in that chapter 12, verse 25, he that loveth his life shall lose it. Who is the one that's always talking, my life, my money, my personality, my glory, my house, my car, my this, my that. And you're always overprotective of yourself. He that loveth his life shall lose it. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. If any man serve me, if any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there also shall my servant be. Where is Jesus now? Tell me out loud. If you serve him unreservedly, if you serve him sacrificially, if you serve him forgetting yourself, only remembering the need for the salvation of others, at last, final day, look up, not here, I mean look up to the ceiling, look up beyond the ceiling, where is that? Heaven, you'll be there. I said you'll be there. It says, if any man serve me, him will my Father honor. I pray you'll serve the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, everything you've got. You serve the Lord, and your commitment every time, in everything, everywhere, will be to please the Lord. Philippians chapter 2. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, sought it not robbery to be equal with God, but he made himself of no reputation. King of kings and Lord of lords, eternal Son of God, who had been in heaven from all eternity, he came to this world, and he wasn't seeking reputation, recognition, or the praise of men. And he says, have that same mind. Don't say, my colleagues in the world, they have chieftaincy title, they have political award, they have this and that. He says, he sought no reputation. Drop it. And in the church, all you want, not your own recognition, but you want the exaltation of Christ. He says, he made himself of no reputation, but he took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That's a calling the Lord has given you. You will fulfill that calling. In Philippians chapter 3, reading from verse 7, but what things were gain unto me, those I counted loss for Christ. Deliberately, look at your life. If I will be a man of the world, that's where I will go, that's where I will climb, that's where I will reach. If I were a man of the world, a woman of the world, that will be my gain, that will be my profit, that will be my award, that will be my reward, that will be my recognition. But what things were gain, profit, reward unto me, if I were in the world, all those I counted loss for Christ, yea, doubtless, and I count how many things? I count all things. I count all things, literally, all things that would have been profitable, all things that would have been gain, all things that the people of the world would have appreciated, and they would have said, Mr. So and so, Madam so and so, see what he's got, see what she's got. All the apostles said, because of my appreciation of Calvary, because of my appreciation of the sacrifice of Christ, because of my understanding that Calvary demands my totality, it says, all those things now I count loss for Christ. It says, not just loss, I count them as dung and dross. And he said, I have suffered now the loss of all things, and do count them as dung, as dross, that I may win Christ. That means for you now, they're like the waste that came out of your body. You're not even thinking or willing to touch them anymore. You say, I'm going on, and I burnt the bridge behind me, and I've left all those things behind. All I seek now is the exaltation of Christ and the glorification of Christ. It says in verse 9, I do this so that I'll be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. That's the calling of God for you, for me, for us all. We're going to fulfill that call. And as we fulfill that call, his blessing will be upon our lives. In Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 6, reading from verse 24, no man can serve two masters. If Jesus is Lord, he'll be the only Lord in your life. If Jesus is King, he'll be the only King in your life. If Jesus is Master, he'll be the only Master in your life. Not you competing with Christ. Jesus is Master, you want to be Master too. Jesus is Lord, you want to be Lord too. And Jesus is all in all, you want to be all in all too. He must have the first place, the only place for you to please him. Because no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. That's God and money. Many things people do, they do because money is the master. Because money is the Lord. Money is their king. Money will not replace Christ in your life. Money will not replace the king in your life. Money will not be your Lord, your ruler, your king, your master. Jesus and Jesus only will be your master in Jesus' name. You will follow Christ whatever the price. You'll follow Christ whatever the cost. And as you follow Christ, great. With the blessing of Christ, your life in Jesus' name. Look at this now in John chapter 13. John chapter 13. Reading from verse 13. Ye call me Master and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. Not I was, not I will be, for so I am. You see your Lord? I said, you see your Lord? You see your Master? Then give him all the honor, all the glory, all your life, and live for him. Forget yourself. Forget all those others who want to compete with him and lord it over you. Look at verse 15. For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done. Now you have to follow him. You will follow Christ. I said you will follow Christ. He'll be the master in your life, the Lord, your life, the King in your life. And as you surrender your life fully, not just to be born again, now you are born again, you now say, Lord, I belong to you completely, entirely, totally for the rest of my life. Only what you want, what you will, what you desire, what you command, that I will do. You'll serve him here on earth, he will reward you up in heaven. Are you ready? Rise up and tell the Lord. And say, Lord, here I am. I belong to you. Here I am. I belong to you. Here I am. I belong to you. Tell the Lord. Tell the Lord. It's a moment of consecration, commitment, and absolute surrender. Consecration and non-conformity to this world. Consecration and non-conformity to this world.